Welcome back to RPA and AI Masterclass. In this class, you will learn the different deployment models for RPA bots. So let's get started and understand by end of this class, you will have the fair understanding about what are the different RPA components, how codes are being published and where, and last but not the least, you will learn how bots are being deployed into production environment and what are the different clusters available that makes highly available and highly scalable. So let's get started and understand the different components of RPA. Typically, there are three components of RPA. Number one is IDE, so that is Integrated Development Environment, that is called in UiPath, that is called UiPath Studio. Let me tell you, UiPath Studio is the place where most of the time, 80% of the time, we would be spending time in building, developing and automating our processes. So 80% of the time we spend, and this is the very core component and important part of overall RPA automation. Number two component is robot, so that is called UiPath Agent. So UiPath Agent is a component that creates the runtime environment for the bots to run. So essentially, it's an operating system for the bots that creates environment where bots executes and run into production environment. Essentially, on this robot environment, we don't have the IDE into production. Last but not the least, the last component is control room. So in UiPath, it is being called orchestrator. So this control room or orchestrator is a component that actually monitor, control and deploy the bots. So this is how it works. So all the three components are very important, but let's see how the code deployment happened. That will make more sense in order to logically connect. As we know, most of the time we are spending our time on UiPath Studio in order to build and train a bot. Once the bot is being trained and configured, the bot will be published on the orchestrator. But there is a hack. It all depends on our licensing model, because UiPath comes in a decoupling model where the license buyer may not have the orchestrator license. So in case we have the orchestrator license, then only we can publish on orchestrator, that is the server component. Otherwise, in case we don't have the orchestrator license, we can publish on the desktop as well, or on the same machine where we have the UiPath Studio installed. Now, if my code is being published on orchestrator, the next step would be take the code, take the binary, and then finally deploy the bot on virtual machine or any desktop. So this is how it works. IDE being developed, the code will be published into orchestrator, and finally orchestrator will deploy on the different virtual machine or the desktop, and where bot will be running and executing, and that will be monitored and controlled by the orchestrator. Hope it makes sense. Yeah, so let's get started and understand, in case I don't have the orchestrator in place, then how the code will be published. So it's a very simple process. From IDE, the code will be published on the desktop, and from desktop, we can deploy the code or the binary where we have the UiPath agent installed. In this case, we don't have orchestrator to control and monitor, but it's our whole and sole responsibility to ensure the bots are running and we are giving enough support in order to make sure it's available. Yeah, okay. So let's put all the things together and understand logical view how things happens together. So Studio is the place where we would be building and configuring our bot. After this, we'll deploy on the orchestrator. Orchestrator will have the integration with third-party apps. For example, it might have the integration with CyberArk through the API, third-party API, and then it will have the connectivity with either attended bot or unattended bot. In case it's unattended bot, orchestrator will execute, but in case it's attended bot, it will just attend, because ultimately attended bots are being triggered and executed by the human agents because it's attended. Yeah, and then both the bots have the similar capability in terms of executing Citrix, desktop, web, SAP, any kind of application. So this is how the logical in totality the UiPath works. Yeah, isn't exciting? Yes, it's exciting. Let's move forward and understand the logical architecture, the technological architecture, how it works. So logical architecture is being actually divided into three parts, but actually it's two parts. So let's understand. The top part is nothing but our UiPath Studio and the agents. UiPath Studio and agent, essentially the agent is being connected with the web application. Essentially this is nothing but the orchestrator. So agent is being connected with the orchestrator, and it all happens through the different set of web APIs. So if you look at here, it is connected through configuration, logging, monitoring, queues, API. So in orchestrator, we have the presentation layer where we have the web application where we are interfacing, but essentially it has published, it has interfaced many other API. And then finally, whatever the activity we are performing or whatever the activity bots are performing, the entire data is being stored into SQL Server. So all structured data is being stored into SQL Server. However, all the login data is being stored into Elasticsearch. On top of that, we can run analytics to get the health of the bots. So this is how it works. Just to summarize, client side is nothing but our UiPath Studio and client agent. This has been connected with our orchestrator. Orchestrator has got three different components. One is presentation layer, where we interact. The other layer is the API layer that is being interfaced with SQL Server and Elasticsearch database for the persistent purpose. Yeah. So this is how the UiPath architecture is being laid down. Now, let's understand how can we establish the highly available clusters. Essentially mean that, how can we make sure that our bot environment is highly available and highly scalable. In case any of the bot goes down, it should be managed in such a way that our operation should not be impacted. So if you look at here, all the RPA bots or studio is being connected with network load balancer. So this mechanism, what we are seeing into this architecture, can handle up to 500 to 5000 the RPA bots. And just to let you know that one UiPath orchestrator can handle up to 2500 to 5000 bots. So we just need to buy one orchestrator. But in this case, if you look at here, since it's a highly available clusters, we need to buy two different orchestrator, and it has its own cost implications in order to make sure that my bots are available. So it will be connected with the load balancer, and then it's all on the highly available nodes. And finally, SQL Server is also there on highly available cluster. At the same time, the Elasticsearch and Kibana is also available on the highly cluster, cluster nodes. So there is no possibility of failure because it's all on highly cluster. And then the strategy of active, passive, passive, active, and or active, active, it all depends on the way we are designing. But essentially mean that in case we wanted to establish the highly available cluster, we have to replicate our entire data center. We need to have the network load balancer and highly available cluster. This is how it works to manage 500 to 1000 or maybe 250 to 1000 bots. So this is all for today. Hope to see you into next class. Thank you.